The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you.
Our Lord Jesus Christ says, "If you love me, keep my commandments. Unless I wash you, you have no part in me." Let us confess to Almighty God our sins against his love and ask him to cleanse us. Have mercy on us, O God, in your great goodness, according to the abundance of your compassion, blot out our offences. Lord, have mercy. Against you only have we sinned and done what is evil in your sight. Christ, have mercy. Purge us from our sin, and we shall be clean. Wash us, and we shall be whiter than snow. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May the Father forgive us by the death of his Son, and strengthen us to live in the power of the Spirit all our days. Amen.
Oh, never one of us.
Let us pray. God, our Father, your Son, Jesus Christ, was obedient to the end and drank the cup prepared for him. May we who share his table watch with him through the night of suffering and be faithful. Amen.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Beloved, I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also, after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." This is the word of the Lord.
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and to go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who has bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him. For this reason he said, "Not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So, if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly, I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
May I speak in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. On Sunday, God willing, this place will be full of light and song and joy as we mark the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Easter is the heart of our faith. But it would not have been a great surprise to people in the ancient world that a God could rise from the dead. Gods by definition, not being confined to the mundane limitations of flesh and blood. And many an ancient skeptic, and some modern ones too, have been inclined to dismiss Easter as a story for children, born out of some infantile craving for a happy ending, and they all lived happily ever after. Whereas, the skeptics say, the mature and responsible path is to face our limitations, our mortality, and not to pretend otherwise. And then there have always been those devout skeptics too, people who do believe in the supernatural, but for whom the Easter story is an insult to the majesty of God. How ridiculous to imagine God being placed in a tomb. The resurrection we proclaim is of a real human being, a man who was crucified, the Son of God made flesh, we believe, come to save us. And so, as St. Paul says in our first reading tonight, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes, because his death matters. His death tells us as much about who he is, who God is, as the resurrection does. It makes all the difference that the one who was raised from the dead was the crucified one, not somebody who died peacefully in their sleep. We proclaim the Lord's death until he comes, because in his death there is hope. We often talk about the life of faith as a journey, and of this week in particular as a journey, walking the way of the cross, drawing close to him. But that might make it sound as if this was about us taking the initiative. In a profoundly self-centered age, even for those of us who believe, it can be hard to shake off the culture that reduces everything to a personal lifestyle choice. But tonight, we reckon with where human choices can lead. Not to the carefully filtered image of ourselves that we might present on the latest social media, always smiling, always succeeding, always beautiful. There's a terrible feature on what has become the ubiquitous Zoom called Touch Up My Appearance. Smooths the wrinkles around the eyes and generally airbrushes away any unpleasantness, which is fine until, after months of this, you meet people again in person. Unfiltered. And watch the look cross their face of surprise at how careworn you've suddenly become. Tonight, we reckon with the reality, the crookedness, the smallness, the fearfulness that often characterizes our human nature. Tonight, we reckon with the abuse and corruption of political and religious authority, features not only of the Holy Land in the first century, but here in 2021 too. Left to our own devices, our desire for truth is not strong enough to find the way to the heart of God. God has to come to us. We have to recognize that we are lost and flawed and need to be found. We are here tonight because God has come to us. In Christ, out of love for us all. The Son of God, eternal love, beyond our comprehension, came into history, came to us, took on human flesh and blood to save us, because we needed to be saved from death itself. Not one of us can choose not to die, as we have been reminded with a force some of us had forgotten this last year. And yet, even after this last year, our culture would still rather forget than face death. But we dare tonight and tomorrow to face death because God has been there ahead of us. We have been chosen in love by God, and our hope is in Christ's resurrection, hidden in God forever. So God doesn't come as a tourist, but as one of us, as the poorest and the most selfless of us, as a slave, washing feet, serving food, descending into the depths of hell, so that there is nowhere where the glory of God has not shone. The resurrection of Jesus Christ gives us hope because of who it was who died and how he died. Humiliated, crucified, the punishment given to rebellious slaves. He will be stripped entirely, not left in a loincloth, as artists often coyly suggest. And tonight he touches the disciples. There's something powerfully intimate about having your feet washed. It's a reminder of what it means to be in the hands of love, as babies. The very old and sick are washed by others. And so it is that God washes us spiritually with tenderness. It's an act of service. But God's self-effacing love is most perfectly expressed in those living signs he gives, his life given to us in bread and wine. Those pregnant symbols of life, of abundance, of feasting, of company shared. They're not symbols of social distancing. He gives us his life to eat and drink. There could be no more powerful expression of the completeness of God's selflessness. And tonight, it's important we remember that Jesus comes as a Jew. And in the events of his life, but especially those of the next 3 days, threads from throughout Jewish history and scripture converge. We pray the Psalms here daily because we encounter his character in them, although they were written centuries before he was born. And they gathered, he and his disciples, for Passover, when they remembered how their ancestors had been saved by God from slavery and from the death that fell on the firstborn of Egypt. And in his sacrifice, there are echoes too of the Jewish Day of Atonement, when the sins of many were placed on the shoulders of one whose life was given that all might live. Christ offers himself in that spirit, and we receive him tonight as pure gift. And those of us who are not Jews by ancestry receive the gift of this spiritual treasure with particular humility tonight, because so often we have turned the story of his betrayal and passion into grounds for anti-Semitism rather than a mirror to ourselves in need of redemption. Tonight is good news for those who are lost. It's good news for those who feel broken and weary. It's good news for those who are grieving and heartbroken, because God has come to us. God has been confined within flesh and blood and a particular culture. It is absurd to think God could be confined in a small tomb or a small manger or even a fully grown man. But that was God's choice, made in love, so that we, who are flesh and blood, might live forever in the Spirit. By his wounds, we are healed. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
One of the unique and powerful symbols in this service is the washing of feet, reenacting Jesus' servant ministry, reminding us of his mandate to love one another. Sadly, we cannot do it as we normally would, perhaps with 12 different people representing the disciples, representing the diversity of this cathedral company. But this year, because of social distancing, it will just be my wife Stella and me washing each other's feet. But as we do so, or if you prefer to keep your eyes shut, whatever helps you, maybe you can reflect on this last year of how metaphorically you have washed the feet of others, for that is being obedient to the command of God. And also how you might afresh, as it were, exercise that ministry of serving others and allowing yourself to be served as well. And I think for me, the words of a song, of a hymn, sums it up. Brother, sister, let me serve you. Let me be as Christ to you. Pray that I may have the grace to let you be my servant too. Lord Jesus Christ, you have taught us that what we do for the least of our brothers and sisters, we do also for you. Give us the will to be the servant of others, as you were the servant of all, and gave up your life and died for us, but are alive and reign now and forever. Amen.
In the power of the Spirit, let us pray to the Father through Christ, the Saviour of the world. Father, on this, the night he was betrayed, your Son, Jesus Christ, washed his disciples' feet. We commit ourselves to follow his example of love and service. Lord, hear us and humble us. On this night, he prayed for his disciples to be one. We pray for the unity of your church. Lord, hear us and unite us. On this night, he prayed for those who were to believe through their message. We pray for the mission of your church. Lord, hear us and renew our zeal. On this night, he commanded them to love but suffered rejection himself. We pray for the rejected and unloved. Lord, hear us and fill us with your love. On this night, he reminded them that if the world hated them, it hated him first. We pray for those who are persecuted for their faith. Lord, hear us and give us your peace. On this night, he accepted the cup of death and looked forward to the new wine of the kingdom. We remember those who have died in the peace of Christ. Lord, hear us and welcome all your children into paradise.
Jesus says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Do not let your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. The peace of the Lord be always with you."
And also with you.
At distance, we exchange a sign of peace. Perhaps if you want to use deaf sign language, peace of the Lord be with you. At the Eucharist, we are one with our crucified and risen Lord. We know that it was not only our ancestors, but we who were redeemed and brought forth from bondage to freedom, from mourning to feasting. We know that as he was with his disciples in the upper room, so our Lord is with us now. Until the kingdom of God comes, let us celebrate this feast. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right to give you thanks, Father most holy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For on this night he girded himself with a towel, and taking the form of a servant, washed the feet of his disciples. He gave us a new commandment, that we should love one another as he has loved us. Knowing that his hour had come, in his great love, he gave this supper to his disciples to be a memorial of his passion, that we might proclaim his death until he comes again and feast with him in his kingdom. Therefore, earth unites with heaven to sing a new song of praise. We too join with angels and archangels as they proclaim your glory without end. Holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who on this night, the night when he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me."
Christ is the bread of life. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, Lord Jesus, until you come in glory.
And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption as we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. We bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send your Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we in the company of all the saints may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. Trusting in the compassion of God, let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Heavenly Father, as we participate with your people in these holy mysteries, we pray you now to grant to those who seek it your gift of spiritual communion, with trust in your faithfulness and your abiding love. Amen. The body of Christ, broken for us. The blood of Christ, shed for us. Amen.
Thank you.
Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you that in this wonderful sacrament, you have given us the memorial of your passion. Grant us so to reverence the sacred mysteries of your body and blood, that we may know within ourselves and show forth in our lives the fruit of your redemption. For you are alive and reign now and forever. Amen.
Lord, my God, who have borne me, I have so forsaken thee, and God so far from thy mouth.
When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them, "You will all become deserters because of me this night, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go ahead of you to Galilee." Peter said to him, "Though all become deserters because of you, I will never desert you." Jesus said to him, "Truly I tell you, this very night, before the cock crows, you will deny me 3 times. Peter said to him, "Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you." And so said all the disciples. Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took with him Peter and the 2 sons of Zebedee and began to be grieved and agitated. Then he said to them, "I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and stay awake with me." And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Yet not what I want, but what you want." Then he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, "So could you not stay awake with me 1 hour? Stay awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." Again he went away for the 2nd time and prayed, "My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done." Again he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the 3rd time, saying the same words. Then he came to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand." While he was still speaking, Judas, 1 of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him." At once he came up to Jesus and said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus said to him, "Friend, do what you are here to do." And they came and laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. Suddenly one of those with Jesus put his hand on his sword, drew it, and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Jesus said to them, "Put your sword back into its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father, and he will at once send me more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled, which say it must happen in this way?" At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds, "Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day I sat in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But all this has taken place so that the scriptures of the prophets may be fulfilled." Then all the disciples deserted him and fled.